Thanks for checking out this online resource. We here at Calvary Community Church hope it's a help to you in your own spiritual journey. But online resources can't replace our engagement with the local church, where we can serve with others, we can worship with others, we can do life together and reach out to the community. If you live near Calvary, we invite you to join us 6 p.m. Saturday or 9 or 11 Sunday morning for one of our weekend services. If you live at a distance, just email us at info@calvarycc.org and we'll help you find a church where you can get grounded and growing in Christ. Well, I see you have survived the first winter storm of 2019, right? You know, when you come from the East Coast, you move here as we did 10 years ago, you know, you kind of laugh at Californians over that kind of thing. Then after you've been here 10 years, you get your parka out, you bear down and get ready for the winter storm. Glad to see you here this morning, and glad you did make it through all the rain and all. You know, years ago, there was a song that was released in 1988, and it was one of the most popular songs of that year. See if you, even when you hear the first couple bars of this song, know what song it is. Yep.
Don't worry. Be happy.
Bobby McFerrin's Don't Worry, Be Happy, 1988. 25 years later, Pharrell Williams wrote a song for Despicable Me 2 that kind of became a popular song, and you'll recognize this right away, too. Now, back in 1988, we made mixtapes, you know, that would include, and that was one of the songs I had on one of those that I had, Bobby McFerrin's Don't Worry, Be Happy. Now, if you don't know what a mixtape is, it's kind of like a playlist, but a lot more work. And then in the playlist I have right now, one of my playlists where I have a lot of light, upbeat, fun songs, I have Pharrell Williams' Happy. Both those songs just kind of lift your spirits, bring a smile to your face. But when you read the words and you think about what they're describing as happiness, it's pretty fluffy. It's like having your feet firmly planted in midair. McFerrin, in the song that he sang, it was popular in 1988, he says, "Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now." That's about as deep as it gets in understanding where happiness comes from. And in the song Happy, clap along if you feel like happiness is the truth. Clap along if you know what happiness is to you. But where does the happiness, the joy, the meaning, the satisfaction come from? And there have been world philosophies that have shaped songs and poetry and culture. One form of philosophy, hedonism, says that happiness is found in pleasure. So just party and pursue every pleasure of life. That's where happiness and joy is found. The opposite of that, moralism, says you need a code to live by. Whatever that code is, the right and wrong, and you live your life disciplined according to those rules, those laws. Existentialism says that we can determine, because of our free will and our individual agency in this life, we can determine our future and shape the future of others by how we exist and how we behave. The opposite of that is fatalism. Fatalism says you have nothing to do with how life is heading for you or for others. You just got to find happiness in laying back and letting it happen, and don't try to fight it, because it's just this force of nature of the world that's taking place. Then in the area of theism, there are people who believe in various world religions and even some forms of Christianity, that there was a God who created everything, it fell apart, and sin and suffering entered into the world, and now that God is distant from us, and he's way out there, and he can't relate to us, and we can't relate to him, and so you just try to make your way in figuring out who he is based on how you view the world. Biblical Christianity, however, says there is a God who made us, who wants to have a relationship with us, and even since sin entered the world and suffering entered the world with the fall of Adam and Eve, that God has sought to restore our relationship with him, and he wants to walk with us, not just in eternity, but he wants to walk with us through the ups and downs of our lives today so that we can really have joy, happiness, and meaning in a personal relationship with him. Today we're going to continue our Courageous Faith series that was started last week so well by Pastor Brian Howard. And he kicked it off well. This study is going to be looking at the lives of the Old Testament prophets Elijah and Elisha. Elisha succeeds Elijah. And so we're going to look at Elijah first. And Brian really helped us last week get an understanding of the setting of the book and who the main of these characters are, and even looked into the book of 1 Kings to help us understand the environment of their culture and their world. Today, as we talk about no other way to be happy, and we look into 1 Kings chapter 17, if you want to go there in your Bibles, 1 Kings 17, 1 through 16. Go there on your mobile device. You can Google that reference, 1 Kings 17, and then look for the first verse of that that chapter in that book. I want us to see this today. The only way to be truly happy in life is to trust and obey God more every day. Now, what I'm going to talk about today is not easy. We're going to talk about how hard it can be to trust God. We're going to talk about hard obedience. But when we understand there's a God to whom we're accountable, and one day we will return to Him, and we will stand before Him and be accountable to Him, and as we live our lives today, the only way to find true happiness and meaning is to be in sync with that God and how He sees the world and how He is working out the things of this world for eternity. The only way to be truly happy in life is to trust and obey God more every day. Now, last week, Brian helped us understand some of the setting. We talked about Elijah. We talked about a king named Ahab, the king of Israel, and his wife Jezebel, who'd come from the land of the Phoenicians. And we got an introduction to the fact that Ahab had done evil more than the kings before him. And I want us to go back and understand the setting of the story of Elijah, the prophet. Elijah ministers really in the middle of the 9th century B.C., and he ministers in a time and speaks for God in a time when the nation of Israel, God's people, the 12 tribes of Israel have been divided. And to understand that, we need to step back, and I'm going to geek out a little bit here with some timelines. We're going to begin with King Saul, who was the first king of all 12 tribes of Israel. And then his successor was King David. And David unified and took the land, all the land that God had promised to Israel, and established a strong kingdom. Then his son Solomon took over, and it was a time of peace, a time of economic prosperity in the United Kingdom of Israel. But then Solomon's son, Rehoboam, squandered his leadership, made some poor choices, and the tribes divided. 10 tribes to the north and 2 tribes to the south. The northern kingdom became known as Israel, the southern kingdom as Judah. And by the time we get to the middle of the 9th century, we have a king that shows up named Ahab in the northern kingdom of Israel. And Ahab is the 8th kingdom of the north. And the northern kingdoms, the nation of Israel, those kings were constantly turning their back on God and bringing immorality into the country. And Ahab is one who is described, as we saw last week, who brought some of the most evil and wicked practices into the nation of Israel. And it is Elijah who shows up to speak to Ahab. And he speaks to Ahab, but not only Ahab, but he speaks to his wife, Jezebel. Now, right away, we know Jezebel is probably not a good woman, because most of us know that name. But how many of you have named one of your daughters Jezebel, you know? Wouldn't that be quite an announcement? Mom and Dad, we've had our firstborn. It's a little girl, and her name is Jezebel Grace. We know that name is associated with immorality. Jezebel was from the city of Sidon. She was a Sidonian. That would be in modern Lebanon today. We know this people group and this empire as the Phoenicians. And her father was the king of the Sidonians, or the Phoenicians. They worshiped Baal. And the form of Baal they worshiped was that Baal was the god of rain and brought the rain in time for the crops and all that. And she, when she married Ahab, was allowed by Ahab to bring the worship of Baal into the nation of Israel. There were a lot of pagan, immoral sexual practices a part of that worship. There was violence, bloodletting, a lot of things that happened that were just contrary to the worship of the one true God, Jehovah, and that all entered in. So Elijah comes and he shows up, and as we saw last week and in verse 1 of chapter 17, he says it's not going to rain until God says it's going to rain, because Ahab, he's trying to get your attention. You've turned your back on the God of your fathers and he wants your attention. There's going to be a drought. The drought is going to cause a famine. It's going to cause misery, not just here in Israel, but even into Judah and into the surrounding areas. And I won't show up again until God says it's time for rain. And so Elijah speaks to Ahab in that era. Now, we've looked at the timeline a little bit and how it fits into the Bible, biblical history. I want to look at the geography of this so we understand where Ahab lived, where Jezebel was from, who Elijah is, and where he's from. So this first map just shows the division of the kingdoms. 10 tribes to the north in the nation of Israel, 2 tribes to the south in the nation of Judah. Now, down in the south, Judah, the capital city of Judah, was Jerusalem. And so Jerusalem becomes the capital there of that southern kingdom of the 2 tribes. In the north, Israel, the capital city becomes Samaria, not to be confused with the Samaritans that come along centuries later in the time of Jesus. But Samaria is the capital of the northern kingdom. Elijah's ministry is to the northern kingdom. Most of his career in speaking for God was under the reign of Ahab. And so all that we're talking about takes place in the nation of Israel. Elijah goes to Samaria and confronts Ahab. And I wanted you to get a little understanding of how the Phoenicians, see them up to the north, what would be Lebanon today. And you see the city of Sidon up there in the white. Jezebel is from up there. And they were the ones who worshiped Baal and saw him as a god of rain. And so hopefully that gives you some timeline, gives you a little bit of a sense of the geography of this. But also then, I want you to understand the setting that Pastor Brian helped us understand last week in terms of the moral setting of Israel in Elijah's day. We talked about they had a problem of idolatry. They had replaced Jehovah as the God of Israel, and they brought in carven images, stone images, idols, and put them in the center of the life of Israel over Jehovah God. Now, we look at that and we go, idolatry, that was true back then. In that culture, it can't be true today. Oh, it's just as true today. It's deceptive and subtle. It's when we put a person, a career, a thing, our stuff, anything at the center of our lives other than Jesus Christ. We have idolatry as a problem just like they did in their day in our culture. And the second thing is syncretism. Brian mentioned this, and the idea that you bring in all different religious philosophies, you kind of take pride in the fact you've gathered a little bit from everywhere, and then you sprinkle a little Jesus on top. And they had done that. Oh, Baal works, we'll keep Jehovah too. And they'd brought in other gods, and it was just this clump of stuff. And syncretism is definitely a part of our culture today and our world today. Then the third one was rebellion, just outright rebellion. We know what God's word says. And the nation of Israel had come to this point. Ahab had come to this point. We know what God says, but we reject it because we want to live the way we want to live. That's rebellion. Do you think that marks our culture today? Yes. Unfortunately, idolatry, syncretism, and rebellion have even crept into the American church in a lot of ways, in a lot of places. It can creep into our lives. So that's kind of the moral setting. Then Brian helped us and introduced us to Elijah, this prophet. He really arrives. His arrival is he shows up out of nowhere. We don't know anything about his background. We know he's from a town called Tishbe on the other side of the Jordan from Samaria. We don't know a lot about him. He shows up as an adult and as a prophet and confronts Ahab and says it's not going to rain. What does Elijah's name mean? His name means the Lord, and when you see Lord in all caps in the Old Testament, that's a reference to Jehovah. Jehovah is my God. And what a great name for a prophet who shows up to bring God's judgment. The Lord is my God. What was Elijah's mission? His mission was to save God's people, to help Ahab see the wickedness of his ways, and to cause him to repent and turn back to Jehovah God. So hopefully that helps you with some of the setting of what's taking place in the reign of Ahab, and Elijah shows up. Now Elijah's delivered these words, and these are not popular words. And when the drought starts and the longer it goes, the more in danger Elijah is. He is not popular in Israel. Ahab probably wants him killed. We know that he goes and kills all kinds of prophets of the Lord Jehovah. Probably word has reached the Phoenicians and the city of Sidon and to Jezebel's father that this Elijah guy is the one who's caused this drought that was even affecting the Phoenicians, the Sidonians. And we now come to 1 Kings chapter 17, and I want to begin with verse 2, if you want to follow along as I read. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, leave here. You got to get out of Samaria. You're not safe here. God had plans to hide him away for the years there'd be this drought and famine and devastation. And he's going to use those years to prepare Elijah for what he has for him next. He says, leave here, turn eastward and hide in the Carit Ravine east of the Jordan. Now, I want you to understand where that is on the map because we want to understand some of the movements. The Carit Ravine that had the Carit Brook would be over on the side of the Jordan, right on the no man's land of Israel's border. They would be considered Israelites in this area, but it's a very desolate area. And the brook there was probably one of these things that was there when the rain came, and then after a while it dried up. And so he's told to go to Carit, which is near his hometown of Tishbe. Verse 4, you will drink from the brook, and I have directed the ravens to supply you with food. Now, there's a problem as Elijah hears this. We have to hear it as Elijah heard it. You're going to go to the brook at Carit in the Carit Ravine. Now, he's from that area, and we know from the geography in that area that these are really dry creeks, dry wadis, dry riverbeds. And if you're from California, you understand this. Where I'm from in Indiana, there's always water in the river. There's always some water in the creek or the brook. But here in California, there are a lot of dry riverbeds, dry creeks, big, wide ones. And when I first moved here, I thought, what do you mean that's a river? That's just a trench. That's not a river. But then when it rains, like we had last night, those things fill up. The water moves. And it's the same kind of thing. So Elijah's probably saying, wait, you're going to send me to a brook that's going to be one of the brooks that first dries up in the drought? It probably is a stumble for him at first. And then he says, and there the ravens are going to feed you. And we know from the kind of ravens that populate the Middle East that these ravens are terrible at feeding their young. I don't know what you call baby ravens. We'll call them ravenettes. But these ravenettes are starving, and they would lay a lot of eggs, and there might be, you know, 20 little ravenettes. Almost said raisinettes. Ravenettes. And maybe three make it because the mother and the father would forget to feed them. And that was very known in that culture. So you have him hearing God say, go to Carit, the brook that'll probably dry up sooner than others. And the ravens, who can't even take care of their own, are going to take care of you. But look at his response, verse 5. So he did what the Lord had told him. He went to the Carit Ravine east of the Jordan and stayed there. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Verse 7, sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Elijah probably had been measuring it, probably trying to get water out of little pools that are left as it's drying up. He sees it happening, and there had been no rain in the land. Verse 8, then the word of the Lord came to him. God speaks to him. Go at once to Zarephath. Now, Zarephath is not in Israel, not even in Judah. Zarephath is not in kind of the desolate land east of the Jordan where he was from. Zarephath is up in the region of the Phoenicians, the Sidonians, where Jezebel is from. And this map kind of tells us the journey he would take would be about a 90-mile journey from the Carit Ravine, the Carit Creek. And can we bring that one up? The next, yeah, it's from Carit to Zarephath. He's going to make this 90-mile journey up around the Sea of Galilee or the Lake of Galilee and go into the territory of the Phoenicians, the Sidonians. He's going into the belly of the beast where this is all the problem in Israel's coming from. The next slide shows us how close Zarephath was to Sidon. It's less than 10 miles to Jezebel's hometown. Archaeologists tell us that this region of Lebanon, specifically where Zarephath was, that area is now known in that time of Ahab to be an area where there was intense Baal worship. Matter of fact, it's where all the hipsters went to worship Baal of the Phoenician Empire. And So it's interesting, he is going into, and Zarephath is not just some little village, it's a city with gates, we'll read. He's going into the belly of the beast. If there's anybody looking for him other than Ahab and his wife Jezebel, it's Jezebel's father and the Phoenicians. He's insulted their God. He's caused this great drought that they're experiencing. And he says, go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. Now today, we know that one of the things the church is to do is care for widows and orphans. The New Testament tells us that's true religion. In the ancient world, widows were cut off when their husbands died. They did not get the land that was their husband's. They did not get the resources. It reverted back to his family, and they would keep it and let the widow go and any children she had. And so the idea of being fed by a foreign Gentile widow is about as crazy as being cared for by a brook that's going to dry up and ravens who can't even feed their own children. So as Elijah hears this and receives this, this isn't making sense. But notice what verse 10 says. So he went to Zarephath. He obeyed the word of the Lord. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? This is a common hospitality request, and it would be common for her to go do that, especially when a traveler comes in the gates of a city after a long journey. So this is all very normal. Verse 11, it says, as she was going to get it, so she's going to get the glass of water, he called and said, bring me, please, a piece of bread. And piece there in the Hebrew is a crumb, a little corner of, a little speck of bread. Now this is where this woman, who's been suffering from the drought and the famine, and is a widow cast to the margins of society, is going to have a little problem. Because she's gathering the sticks at the gate, as we're about to find out, to make a fire to cook the last meal for her, this widow of Zarephath, and her son. And we know as we get into the last part of this chapter next week, her son is probably a toddler. And she's already figured out we've got just enough to make a little piece of bread for us to have our last supper, and then we'll wait and die. Because the drought, the famine, the devastation, the judgment of God is even affecting the Phoenicians there at Zarephath. And so we read in verse 12, she responds to him, as surely as the Lord, that's Jehovah, your God lives, she replied. Now we don't know if the Lord prompted her to let her know that he was a prophet of Jehovah, that he was an Israelite, whether he had introduced that, if there was something that was obvious to her about him. But she says, Jehovah, your God lives. I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I got flour in this jar. I got a little olive oil in this jug. And she says, it's just enough. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son that we may eat it and die. I got enough to make one little cake. Now, oil and flour will make a little flatbread that they would push together and stick to the rocks around a fire. And it wouldn't raise or anything like that, but it would be a substantive meal in that day. But this is going to be their last meal. And then she's going to watch her son die, and then she's going to die because of this drought. And Elijah said to her in verse 13, don't be afraid, go home and do as you have said. But first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Here's God's word through Elijah to this woman. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord, Jehovah, sends rain on the land. Not Baal, the rain god, but the Lord Jehovah. You're going to keep that little bit of flour and that little bit of olive oil in that jug and in that jar. It's going to, even when you go to use it, it's still going to be there when you open the jar the next time, just enough for another day's meal until the rains come. Verse 15, she went away and did as Elijah told her. She listened to the word of God. And this, again, hearing it from her standpoint is incredible. But the word of God moves her and she obeys. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family, for the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Now, the implications here in the grammar and the original is that she would make, as she must have done that day, make a little piece of bread. She gave it to Elijah, trusting that there's going to be oil and flour there. She opens them up, and there is, so she can make something for herself and her son. And the next day, there's enough. But when she's done with that, it looks empty. But the next day, she wakes up, and it's there again. Talk about getting your daily bread, right? Now, seeing all these maps and timelines, I'm sorry to have geeked out on you so much, but I think it helps us. It also reminds me that we're working on, and we'll have the final details. We've got it all put together. We're going to do a trip to the Holy Land in February of 2020. Leslie and I will be leading a trip there. And last time I had the privilege of going with Salem Radio as their guest Bible teacher on the trip that was organized. And this one we're organizing ourselves, so I got to pick all the spots where we're going. I'm excited about that, and seeing those maps just energizes me. There's more information about that to come. But what an incredible story. Twice, Elijah hears from God to do something that seems a little out of sync with what others would tell him to do and what he's thinking, but he obeys God's word. Once, the widow hears from God and obeys God. There is a demonstration three times here in these 16 verses of trusting God and obeying God, trusting God and obeying God. And that's where true satisfaction and peace comes from, as we trust and obey him more and more every day. Let me share with you the three steps to true happiness as given in this story, in this passage. First, let me just go over the three, and then I'll get into them more deeply, each one of them. The first thing is, if you want to really be happy in this life, you need to pay attention when God speaks. Pay attention when God speaks. Secondly, after you've paid attention when God speaks, then you got to do what God says to do. Do what God says. And then you have to step back, thirdly, and leave the outcome to God. Now, what I'm about to talk about, trusting God and obeying God, we're going to be talking about hard trust, difficult faith. We're going to talk about hard obedience, difficult obedience. It's important for us to understand these things if we want to experience meaning and joy and true happiness in this life. First, let's look at pay attention when God speaks. So in verse 2, we read, "Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah." Verse 8, "Then the word of the Lord came to him." Verse 14, Elijah speaks for God, "For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says." The word of God came to them. They heard it. They received it. We need to pay attention when God speaks. First and foremost, we need to seek out what God has to say. Seek out what God has to say. A lot of people say to me, "What does God have to say about this in life and that in life and this relationship and this decision I'm going to make with my career?" And I really want God to tell me. When you seek out what God has to say, you have to understand that God has given us already his written word that is powerful. And it speaks into every facet of life. And before you expect God's spirit to nudge you in some other direction or to speak to you in some other way, you got to understand what the scriptures say. You've got to understand what God says on that area of life you're struggling with. Someone has put it this way: "This book is the mind of God, the state of man, the way of salvation, the doom of sinners, and the happiness of believers. Its doctrines are holy, its precepts are binding, its histories are true, and its decisions are immutable. Read it to be wise, believe it to be safe, practice it to be holy. It contains light to direct you, food to support you, and comfort to cheer you. It is the traveler's map, the pilgrim's staff, the pilot's compass, the soldier's sword, and the Christian's character." Seek out what God has to say, first and foremost, in his word. Now, I've recently, in the last couple of years, switched to a digital version of the Bible that I carry with me on my iPad and on my iPhone. For years, I carried a paper copy. Maybe some of you are still more comfortable with that paper copy. I've gotten to the point with the digital version of the app I have, I make notes in that, highlights, sermon notes, everything within this, and wherever I go, it goes with me. You know, I try to back it up. I hope I don't lose it ever, but you can lose a hard copy of the Bible too. But whatever way you're most comfortable, whether it's a hard copy of the Bible, having a digital app that you use and enjoy, maybe you want to memorize the whole thing. That's not bad either if you want to try to do that. I don't know anybody who ever has, but the point is, we've got to understand that when we seek what God has to say, we start with the word of God. Secondly, then, we've got to be willing to submit to what God says. We've got to be willing to say, "Okay, I hear what you say, and now I take my plans, my dreams, my future, my expectations, and I submit them to you." This is not easy, because Because in our world today, whatever philosophy it is, the idea is you control your happiness and you pursue this or that, depending on what philosophy, and then you'll be happy. Someone has put it this way, happiness is letting go of what you think your life is supposed to look like. Because when we have expectations and God has a different plan, it can lead to frustration. Then when we reject the idea that God has a different plan, it leads to greater frustration. C.S. Lewis said, do not let your happiness depend on something you may lose. We can lose people. We can lose stuff. It's key for us not to put our happiness in others or in the things of this world. Nothing that was created, but in the one who is the creator. Psalm 37:4 says, take delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Some people look at that verse and they say, wow, if I just delight in the Lord, I just say, I like you, God. He's going to be this great big candy man and give me everything I want. He'll give me the desires of my heart. So if I want this car, I want that house, or I want that person to be my spouse, I want this relationship, I want that job, I want that position at the office, then that's what I'll do. I'll delight in the Lord. He'll give me all those things I want. No. When you delight in the Lord, you open the Word of God and you let God speak to you, talk to God in prayer, you think about what God wants for your life and how you should live your life. When that happens, what happens is you begin to see what God values and what God prioritizes, what's important to Him. And the more you delight in Him, the more you see this world and your life and your journey of life from His perspective, and the more you see it from His perspective, then the more your own desires of your heart align with His. And so He gives you the desires that have aligned with who He is and what His mission is and what His values are and what His priorities are. That's where we submit to what God says. Thirdly, you not only seek out what God has to say and submit to what God says when you're paying attention to when God speaks, but thirdly, you saturate your life with what God says. You saturate your life. You read it. You read the Word. You meditate on it. You memorize it. You post it. You share it. You understand that it covers every aspect of your life. As you understand the Scriptures, you know that God has spoken into His perspective as the one who created us for what is best for our own satisfaction and meaning and joy. And He addresses issues like our finances, our relationships, our dreams and our goals, our words, our thoughts, our sex lives, our parenting, all aspects, our work ethic. And when you want real happiness, you say, I'm going to pay attention to when God speaks. I'm going to make sure I pursue what He says. I'm going to submit myself to it, and then I'm going to let it saturate every aspect of my life. Let me tell you, it's not always comfortable because you'll want to go this way, and God says this way. But I like how Jeremiah, the prophet who lived a couple centuries after Elijah, how he put it, when I discovered your words, I devoured them. They are my joy and my heart's delight, for I bear your name, O Lord God of heaven's armies. He said, I devoured your word. I had to know your perspective so that I could have joy and delight in my own heart and life. Saturate your life with what God says. The key thought here is, always prioritize what God says over what you think and others say. Always prioritize what God says over what you think and other people say. There are a lot of voices in this world. A lot of well-intentioned voices, good voices, friends, colleagues who speak in. But we got to go back to what does the creator of the universe say for me as his child? The first thing you got to hear is that God loves you and sent Jesus so that he could have a relationship with you, not just in eternity, but that you could walk with him now and hold on to his hand through the journey of life, that he could provide you joy and happiness as you walk with him. You need to understand something like what Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. First thing you need to know is that because of sin, and all of us are sinners, all of us are in need of God's rescue, and only God can rescue us. We can't rescue ourselves. And Jesus came because God loved us. He died. He took that payment we deserve for our sins. was buried and was raised so that we can have life in him. And we can have a relationship with God now and forever, not because of religiosity or doing good things or keeping certain codes or moral laws or even obeying the Bible. It is through Jesus Christ and Christ alone that we can have a relationship with God. And the first part of God's word you've got to latch onto is what it means to have a relationship with him through his son. If you haven't put your faith in Jesus, do that today. I'm going to be in the lobby just for 3 or 4 minutes, maybe 5 minutes after the service, and I need to sneak off to the Calvary welcome reception. But if you speak to me right after the service and say, okay, today I put my faith in Jesus, or I need to talk to someone, we can have a pastor or someone share with you from God's word today. Our care and prayer team are down front every week to pray with people over different issues. You can go up to them and just say, hey, I want to make sure I understand that I have a relationship with God through Jesus, and they'll pray with you and help you know that. That's the first thing. Then child of God, just in the first 6 days now of 2019, what have you done with God's word? Have you opened it? One of the reasons we give you the Take 5 in the bulletin, the digital bulletin, and we put it on Facebook, is it's a devotional every day to get you into God's word. Read the scripture that's there. Read the thoughts that are given. You say, well, I want to go right into God's word if I'm going to read God's word. Well, take John. Read the Gospel of John. Take one chapter at a time, day by day, and let God show you who Jesus is and how he lived and how he loved, and ask God to help you live and love like Jesus. Maybe you say, I just need practical wisdom for every day. Take the Proverbs. There are 31 Proverbs, and so you could read today's Proverbs, Proverbs 6, and allow it to speak into your life. So how much of God's word have you allowed to speak into your life in 2019? Are you like Jeremiah that says, I got an appetite to devour who you are. I want to know what the creator of the universe says about how I should live in this world today. If you want true happiness, you want to trust and obey God more and more every day, pay attention when God speaks. Secondly, do what God says. Do what God says. That seems so simple, doesn't it? But this is where hard obedience comes into play. Do what God says without delay. Remember Jonah? God said, go there. Jonah went there. God had to use a whale to redirect him. When you see what God's word says, don't say, you know, that's pretty uncomfortable in my current relationship. So when this relationship ends, then I'll, you know, 6 months from now, a year from now, then I'll align how I live. You know, this job situation, I had to fudge a little bit, cheat a little bit on the reports and things. And once I get through this project, then I'm going to clean it up. No, when you know what God is saying about how you should live, obey without delay. Do what God says without delay. Do it in the right way. Do it the way God says to do it, not your own way. Say, okay, I'll do that, but I'm going to go about it this way. Do it in the right way. Thirdly, do it with the right attitude. That doesn't mean that you can't wrestle with it, struggle with it. Say, okay, I want to do this in this relationship. I want to use these words because, boy, these words would really motivate these people right now. Doesn't mean when you say, oh, but God says his child shouldn't be marked by these things, and I need to walk in obedience here. It doesn't mean you say, oh, that's just great, I'll do it. It means you're going to wrestle with it and say, but, you know, God, I'm going to do what you want, even though I want this. Leslie and I have 3 kids. They're all in their 20s now. John, who turned 25 this week when he was 5 years old, I remember having a conversation with him. We had taught each of our kids when they were young, you can say, when we'd give them an instruction, if they didn't want to do it, and they wanted to, you know, I'm saying go that way, and they want to go this way, I would say, you can look at me and say, Daddy, I don't want to, but I will. I remember one time when John was like 5 or 6, and I got down on his level, and I said, now, John, I want you to do this. And he really didn't want to do that. He was kind of red in the face, and he gritted his teeth, and he said, Daddy, I don't want to, but I will. I said, well, you know, maybe you could do it a little better attitude. So he tried to put a smile on his face, and he went, Daddy, I don't want to, but I will. I know, you know, there are times like that in our own journey with the Lord where our flesh wants to go one way. People are telling us this is how it ought to be. But I've learned in my journey with the Lord, and many of you have learned this, that when you trust God and you obey God, and even when it's hard obedience, that's where satisfaction, meaning, and happiness and joy comes from in life. So here's the key thought there when you're thinking about do what God says. It's okay to say, Father, I don't want to, but I will. Maybe some of you need to say that to the Lord today. There's been something you've been wrestling with him. Just say, Lord, I want to go this way. And you're saying go this way. I don't want to go that way, but I will. It's hard obedience. Do what God says. Thirdly, leave the outcome to God. Leave the outcome to God. See, in verses 5, 10, and 15, you see the response. When God's word comes, they do what God says. If you look back at the text, verse 5, so Elijah did what the Lord told him. Verse 10, so Elijah went to Zarephath. Verse 15, about the widow, she went away and did as Elijah told her, as he gave her the word of God. And then once they obey and they do what God says, then they leave the outcome to God. He says, okay, I'll go to the brook of Kerit. I don't know how the ravens are going to feed me. This brook isn't going to last long. Okay, I'll go to Zarephath, right to the belly of the beast, right into the heart of the people who worship the false god that's come into Israel. I don't know how this is going to work out, but I'll obey you and I'll do it. And I'll leave the outcome to you. Even the woman, she takes the widow. She takes that little bit of oil and that little bit of flour and makes that one cake. And then she reaches in and there's still more. And the next day there's more and there's more. You got to leave the outcome to God. Sometimes it will match what you want. Elijah wanted food and water. The widow didn't want the jug and the jar to run out of oil and flour. And God provided. Sometimes it will match what you want, and it matches God's greater good and overarching plan that he's accomplishing. Sometimes what you want aligns with what God has planned and what's a part of his plan. And sometimes when you step out on that obedience, it just fits. It just feels right. It just happens. But sometimes it will not match what you want. See, we want to control not only, okay, I obeyed God, now I want this outcome. God, this is the way it has to happen in this marriage. This is the way it has to happen with these kids. This is the way it has to happen with these dollars. This is the way it has to happen with my job. But sometimes it will not match. The outcome God gives may not match what you want. But God's greater good and overarching plan is accomplished. When Joseph's brothers pulled him out of that pit, he'd been crying out and praying to come out of the pit. He thought, thank you, God, this is what I want. And they turned around and sold him into slavery. That's not what he wanted. But God was weaving something greater in his life. When Stephen shared his faith with the people who questioned his faith, the new church was emerging in Acts. He's sharing the good news of Jesus, the hope that's found in Christ. And he didn't want them to stone him. That wasn't what he wanted. But that was working a greater good that God had planned. Sometimes when you leave the outcome to God, it just fits right with what you wanted. And then there are times it doesn't fit with what you wanted. But that's where you have to trust and obey God. This is where we've got to let God be God. And to acknowledge, I have to acknowledge, God, you are God and I am not. I will trust you and obey you and I will leave the outcome to you. This is not easy stuff that I'm talking about. But it's where true meaning and satisfaction and joy and happiness are found. And some of you right now, the Holy Spirit is speaking to you about something in your life that he's convicting you about. And you say, I can't make that decision. I got to keep going this way even though God says this. Maybe it's time in your life for hard obedience today. You see, when we say, God, I know better than you know, then we say, I'm a better God than you are, God. That's a dangerous place to be. You say, but I lost this person I love. I lost this career thing. And I get it. I've had those times in my life. But I have to trust and obey God. Otherwise, if I don't, what happens is I compound the frustration that's already there with more frustration when I'm trying to be a better God than God is. Someone has put it this way, let me read Proverbs 19:21 first. You can make many plans, but the Lord's purpose will prevail. Someone has said, just because you're not in the perfect place you expected to be does not mean you're not in the middle of the perfect plan of God. Here's the key thought. We think about leaving the outcome to God. After we've paid attention to what God has to say, we've done what God says, then we leave the outcome to him. Key thought, by letting God be God through obeying and trusting him, you may experience temporary pain, but you will also experience an ever-deepening eternal hope only available in him. So there are times I step out in obedience, and it doesn't go the way I wanted it to go. But when I trust and obey God day by day, then I begin to experience the hope of Christ that it's not always going to be this way. There's something greater that God is working. And one day I believe I'll look back and you'll look back from eternity and we'll look back at our lives and say, oh my, Lord, I'm so glad. Even though it was painful in that moment, I see what you were doing. It was so much bigger than I could imagine what you were weaving and doing. So if you want to be happy, pay attention when God speaks. Do what God says. Leave the outcome to God. Sometimes we trust and obey. Sometimes we obey and trust. There's no other way to be happy than to trust and obey. Let me ask you, are you happy in life? Maybe you're pursuing some philosophy, some intellectualism, some thoughts that somebody shared with you that to you seem superior to the Bible and God's perspective. Are you happy in life? Are you trusting and obeying God more every day? Are you trusting and obeying God more every day? That's where true happiness comes from. I've shared with you a bit about my mom, who had a traumatic brain injury, and so it brought chaos into our home when I was growing up. There were times my mom would go through bouts of depression where she wouldn't get out of bed for days, but my dad, who worked in a factory, would still expect dinner to be ready. And I remember coming home on many occasions, and mom would be in bed and wouldn't get out of bed, and she would say, well, I thawed some meat, you cook it, and your dad will be home in an hour. I mean, I started cooking like roast and stuff like that and other things that we ate that most people don't think are that appetizing anymore, hamburger helper and mush and these kinds of things. And I started cooking that stuff when I was 7 or 8 years old. And I remember coming home one time, I was about 10 or 11, and my mom had been in bed all day for a couple of days. And I was frustrated because I wanted to watch cartoons. I didn't want to make dinner. But she said, I've thawed the meat. I said, what is it? She said, liver. Oh, wonderful. I'd never cooked liver before. And if you've ever cooked liver, it's not a pretty process, pulling the cow livers out of the little container and rolling it in the flour. And what I would do is I'd call my grandmother, and she would coach me through how to cook this. And so on this occasion, I remember how frustrated I was. I was angry. I was sad. I was asking God, why am I in this home again? Why do I have to do this? Lance next door doesn't have to do this. My cousins don't do this kind of thing. Why do I have to live this life? Why me? And I remember just getting very frustrated and looking at these, you know, cow livers and putting them into an iron skillet on the stove and just being really frustrated and down and sad and mad and frustrated with God and kind of even as a kid kind of talking to God in my own heart. And as the livers were cooking on the stove with the onions, you know, liver and onions, for some reason that goes together. I don't know who decided that at what point. Oh yeah, liver, onions, that's beautiful. As they're cooking on the stove, I went into the living room, and my dad had bought a piano for like $25. It was a little out of tune. We had this piano in our living room. And I sat down at the piano, just really bummed out, wrestling with God over my life and how much it stunk to me. And I opened a hymnal, and I came across a hymn that we sang in the church a lot. Now, I could play the piano a little bit, because at that point I'd taken a couple years of lessons. I had taken 6 years of guitar before this, kind of overlapped with the piano lessons, and then piano lessons, total of 12 years of lessons. Really a waste of my dad's money, and those weekly lessons. But I could plunk out, and I remember sitting there with the hymnal, as if I'm in that moment even now, in my mind's eye, I can remember as like a 10 or 11-year-old sitting there at the piano, and I just sort of plunked out, trust and obey. And God met me in that moment. That song was written in the late 1800s and can be kind of trite a little bit in its sound at times, but God met me in that moment and just spoke to me through the words of that song, like, okay, yeah, life stinks right now for you. You trust me and obey me. Just trust me and obey me. And that song has come up in my heart and mind a lot of times. And it's not Don't Worry, Be Happy or Happy by Pharrell I go to. It's trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. John and I are going to sing that, but you're going to join us. How many of you know Trust and Obey, the old hymn? Let's sing that together, just the first stanza and chorus, and allow God to speak to you in this moment. Where are you finding your happiness, your joy, your meaning? Elijah found it in trusting and obeying his God. The widow of Zarephath trusted and obeyed God. What about us?
When we walk with the Lord, in the light of his word. What a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Father, I pray for someone right now who's wrestling with an area where they know they're making decisions based on what they want, not what your word says. Help them to trust you and obey you. Lord, maybe it's in a relationship, maybe it's in words, an attitude, a choice of ethics at work. I don't know what it is that folks are grappling with. I pray that today you'd help them to trust you and, as hard as it may be, obey you in your word. We know we will then experience what Jeremiah the prophet experienced, that there'll be joy and a delight in our hearts as we live in sync with the God who made us. And Father, I pray for people here who perhaps have been frustrated at the loss of a job or a home, or part of a career, or a person they dearly loved. Maybe they're shaking their fist at you in frustration. I pray that today they'd be able to trust you and obey you, even in light of the sin and evil of this world and the suffering of this world. Father, may we find real joy and happiness as we trust and obey you day by day. May we pay attention to what your word says. May we do what it says. And may we leave the outcome to you and find our joy in you, in who you are, not in our circumstances. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.